Greetings, this is Greg for Tesla Fan Insight. Today's discussion is a revisit of the status of the 2170 battery relative to the new introduction of the Model 3 on July 28, 2017. Bonjour, the gates for Station Oak, Emma All Flybine, and this is Greg for Tesla Fan Insight. Today's discussion focuses on what's new that we learned about the 2170 battery with the introduction of the Model 3. Today's talk is going to go through two zones. One is to take a look at what did we learn about the 2170 from its introduction in the form of the Model 3, and then how does this information impact what's going on with the semi-truck introduction in September. So to start off, I wanted to mention that I've kind of been around the auto review business for about 20, 25 years. And when I first started out, we were in the world of the Trans Am with a very large engine. And the Europeans introduced six-cylinder engines with 24 or 32 valves. So it was a smaller engine, but it generated a lot of power. And the fact that it was a lighter engine meant that the engine weight was not hampering performance the way a V8 did. So it was a different way to enjoy a car, if you will. So in the case of the 2170, there's some interesting statistics about that engine. The first part of this statistic is the fact that there are two versions of the Model 3 being introduced. One of them has a range of 215 miles. And that is the weight of the vehicle and battery pack is 3,500 pounds. The second iteration gives you a range of 300 miles plus. And the difference is that the weight is 300 pounds extra. So nobody has seen this battery pack, but there's a number bouncing around of the fact that there are about 4,000 of the new 2170 cells in the battery pack for a Model 3, and there's about 8,000 of those cells for the 18650 in a Model S or a Model X. What this results in is the battery weight for a Model 3 is half of that of what you would see in a Model X or an S. So again, the difference in battery weight with car is, let's say it's 3,800 pounds for 300 miles if you're driving a Model 3. It's 5,900 pounds for a Model S that goes 300 miles. And so completely different sort of weight implications. My general thumbnail sketch is that the Model 3's battery pack is a little more than one half the weight, but the amount of power it generates is actually greater. So I believe what this means is that you're in a great situation because you're using less metal on that battery pack with the new 2170. So the battery pack doesn't weigh as much. So now, you know, it's not part of the weight that slows down the amount of distance you can go based on a charge. Now let's transition over to how this is going to affect the semi-solution. So with all the calculations that were done in terms of a viable amount of weight carried combined with weight in terms of cargo that's carried, combined with the battery weight and cost, what we're finding is that this battery is going to basically half the cost of the previous battery, and it's going to be also half the weight. So that halving of cost will affect both semi and Model 3s, because I think this allows the car to be profitable below 30 grand, and it also will cut the cost of a semi-truck in half. But more importantly, on the semi case, I believe this allows you to get into that 500 to 600 mile range distance we talked about, it's kind of a minimum standard for a Class A truck to be effectively viable. So continuing on our discussion regarding the trucking impact of the 2170, you basically have a battery that's half the weight of its predecessor. The price will therefore be down, but it's slightly more powerful. So it's a win-win all around for Tesla and for the customers receiving this product. When it comes to the semi situation, the only solution for cars and now trucks is to really use lithium ion because of the weight of that battery compared to other methods of storage. So in the case of the solution for the trucks, I believe that this is a huge breakthrough. I'm kind of fascinated by the situation because, again, we've talked about the relationship between Mercedes and Tesla. And one of the challenges that's popping up is that you have customers that are happy with short-range solutions when it comes to short-range solutions, meaning 100-mile or less solutions. The 18650 battery works fine. Panasonic is building facilities that will allow Tesla to provide that battery for those short-range vehicles without any difficulty in the beginning of 2018. So I believe what we're going to see is Tesla separating the 18650 battery from the 2170 battery in terms of solutions that it's used in, because there's a shortage of the 2170 that'll be in place for a couple of years, and the 18650 works fine. It's already been tested in on a number of Mercedes and Fuso products, so there's really no good reason to make an immediate change. But I think that into the future, as 2170 supply grows, you'll see a transition to it because it is a lower cost solution that gives you more range with less weight. So when I saw what was going on with this battery, I was sort of shocked because I have to admit that I was expecting the 2170 to maybe be a 30% better solution in terms of weight and price, etc. But I think a 50% better solution is earth-shattering, and I think it'll be very hard for other firms to compete with what Tesla's accomplished here. So I'll go on to say that another thing that came about that you may have seen is that Elon Musk talked about the fact that we now have a situation where they were using a Model S as a way to power a light that was illuminating the stage for Elon Musk. I think that this is a big situation as well, because one of the suggestions I'd made as a possibility for the battery packs of Tesla was to have basically a mobile facility for transferring power. So in the case of Tesla, what I'm suggesting is that you can use either of the battery packs and make the S or the X or the Model 3 basically your own portable storage facility for power. So you could theoretically take a few of these vehicles to some place that need portable power and power those facilities from the car. So for example, I mean, this is a strange example, but one example would be, what if you took let's say a Model S or a couple of them and rig them together and put them outside a factory that needs power for that day? You could then use the power from those cars and then have both cars go to the supercharger, recharge themselves, and come back to power the factory on the next day. Now, there's a bunch of reasons why this isn't going to happen, but I just thought it was fascinating because there are some interesting possibilities that open when you start using the vehicle and its power pack as a backup power solution. So I'm fascinated by what's going to occur. Look forward to your comments. This is Greg for Tesla Fan Insight. Please like and subscribe. I know we had a lot of noise today. I'm going to show you why, but eager to hear what your comments are. Thanks and have a great day, and look forward to our next conversation. Please like and subscribe.